The chef life is not different from the directing life. You basically stand around all day.
Right. Was it Mary Batali who made them like hot?
Huh? I don't mind at all.
They had been wearing them for a while. A friend of ours, a chef here in LA, had had them when they first. I was like, where did you get those cool rubber shoes? Are they from like the Netherlands or something? Have they switched from wood? That's the most important aspect of the decision making for any director. Who is the caterer going to be? This is like essential.
So do you have one caterer you guys use in Germany?
We actually invented the catering system.
Yeah.
Reinvented the catering system.
We brought a new catering system to Berlin.
Really?
Various opportunities and offers. So you can have a choice. You can have a choice even between the kitchens, meaning...
Huh. The Thai wife of the special effects guy...
is an amazing cook.
...started cooking for us.
Because I'm vegetarian and she would make...
On V for Vendetta. And so it became just for us. And then she opened a little walk station.
And it would have a line.
The line would double and she had to... She opened a catering business after that, and then we had like the German catering, which was all stews and schnitzel and all this heavy duty German style food.
Which is important for some people.
Yeah, no, it's, we didn't do away with it, but then we had the option of having, stir fry, and it was.
And I, of course, immediately took that idea over. From now on, it's the rule.
It has to be the rule.
It's our one disagreement. Who would get?
We did. That was our one fight. We were like, who's getting Siam?
Because we were shooting simultaneously. When they were doing Speed Racer in Berlin, I was doing the International. Mm-hmm. And I said, I want her. And of course, you invented her in a way. So like, I couldn't really go.
Hands off.
But I think she came because we had 3 more weeks of overlap. I think she did the last 3 weeks.
Yeah,
and it was insane because like 150 people were storming towards her the first day she appeared.
She's an incredible cook. But that was one way that we were able to change him and his like the sort of material way that you make a movie. But then we discovered this approach to making movies where you do the music in the beginning, which makes so much sense, but nobody does it. And we did it on this movie, and he's done it on all of his movies, and we were like, at first, like, you can't do that. That's against the rules. Nobody does it that way. And he's like, yeah, it worked. And then we listened to the music during the read-through of the cast, and the cast was like, and we're like, oh my God, how can you leave something so important in the making of a film to the end after you've done all of the design, all of the development, all of the aesthetic choices, then get to the end and, splash
some
music.
It becomes incredibly when you start cutting with the music and you're not cutting with music from other movies on your film. It's it's like going into somebody's house and putting on their clothes, It's just something that's not right about it.
But it's nice to have Tom, I guess, doing it. You don't have to find John Williams somewhere and go through all that process.
We actually think we're going to invent this new job called post-production director. And we'll get to a certain point, we'll like do all the visual effects, and then once we're done with the visual effects, we'll just turn the movie over to Tom. It's going to be a contractual thing. He'll do all the music, the sound, we'll just come in once in a while, check it out.
Is your second sign-up?
It's just fun because it's one of the testaments. Testaments? Do you say testimony? Or is it is testimony?
It's a testament to.
It's testament to all the beautiful aspects of our relationship, our love and friendship and collaboration is that also on top of the fact that we feel that we are so in tune about so many things and we have such an incredible amount of agreement in terms of aesthetic desires and interests and yet a lot of stuff to talk about still within that even our particular strengths, they also matched up so unbelievably well, like incredibly well. You know, stuff where, you know, they would say like, okay, yeah, that needs to be done too. I would say like, that's my favorite thing. And the other way around, where I feel like, I don't know, how do you actually do this? They're like, oh, well, we know, we've done this before.
So how did you guys all first hook up? How did this all start?
We met on
lonelydirectors.com.
It's this website where when you really have tears about the insane loneliness.
Directing is kind of lonely. I mean, luckily, you know, we have each other, and so. But I look at poor directors who work all by themselves, and I think, oh my God, it's got to be one of the loneliest things you can do.
So how far back does it go?
It's 10 years.
It was 12. No, it's like.
I think it's 90, 10 years.
Yeah, 11
so
years.
Heaven or 90, run
2000.
Run?
It's 2000.
Yeah, just, no.
2001.
We met while we were doing a post for Reloaded and Revolutions. And we had been sending notes to each other via our agencies and, you know, oh, do you like me? Check this box, yes or no. And he came out to L.A. Under the pretense that, you know, maybe he'd do some music for one of the cues in
Revolutions.
Hmm. And
it was a good setup. I mean, there had to be some reason, because of course they were like monstrously working, and I was secretly also a bit curious about how do artists look, filmmakers, when they've had a 277 shooting schedule in one go, and then another, I don't know, 1.5 years of post. How much of humanity is left on those bodies and faces? And they were actually really pretty exhausted, and you could tell that. I mean, it was such a monumental, completely disproportional, absurd undertaking, the whole thing, and yet they were still there, and they were still at least alive and somewhat kicking. But also, I came in and I felt like there was like. An interest in this idea, oh yes, right, we could have a nice chat with somebody who's really interested in stuff that we're interested in. Maybe we should go for dinner for a change after 2 years of being locked into this space.
We were kind of like Nell in the beginning. We had forgotten language. It was like, it was lost to us. And he walked in the door and we were just kind of like,
and I was babbling away.
Subterraneans spinning
around. Yeah, we were afraid. We could only go in. We were Morlocks. We could only go out at night. It was like the sun burnt our flesh. And, you know, he said, yeah, let's go out for dinner. And we were like, a date? And then we just began to get a window, like that Somni window where she's looking out, and there's this sort of beautiful half light and the snowflakes, and we suddenly remembered that there was this whole other world, and there was a love for cinema and our art form that you kind of, I think anyone who goes through something so difficult, you know, you become detached from that somewhat, and you're just like, you're so insulated by your experience, and it's so intense, and you're just. And you're trying to make everything perfect, and you can't look up. And then suddenly he was like, look up, look up, remember. And it was like, we had such a great night, and it was invigorating, and it was nourishing.
And that was like the first director that we'd ever met, really. I mean, we had met guys, but you always meet them in passing. And it's just like, maybe you're at an event, or you're walking by, you're at the studio, oh, there's that guy.
So is that the Chicago thing, or is that that you were not in town, or was that...
Probably a combination that we don't live in L.A., and we're naturally very shy and private.
But it's also, I mean, if you don't look out for it, it doesn't happen easily, because, I mean, usually we do work a lot. Then when we really go in public contexts, it's mostly professional. We have to, you know, take care of the people that we're working with, or, you know, with the actors or with our production. And, I mean, you don't hang around in places where other directors hang around. It just is really rare.
Well, I guess film festivals are the one place where directors get to meet.
Well, but they get to meet going away from the stage where they just had a public announcement or like a press conference, you meet behind them, behind the stages of the press conferences, but you don't.
Telluride, a little bit, but
yeah, I never went there. I don't know that. But I mean,
there should be a director's website.
It's not that
we need a support group.
I mean, it's not that
it started. We would all be there.
It's obviously not in existence. I mean, I have a company with two other directors for 18 years now, and they're really friends. So it does exist. But even that came out of the same, you know, desire. You know, to not have a company just with people who run the business, but also with people who really share, you know, the subjects that drive you to even want to have a company. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but even us, you know, those directors that I have my company there with, like Wolfgang and Dani, they have also usually always been shooting, and then I have been shooting, and they have been shooting, so you always can, you can visit each other, but it's not this kind of friendship, it's hard. And, you know, it's not a surprise that many of our friends in our real lives are very often, I mean, one of my best friends in my life is the cinematographer I work with, because we get to spend so much time with each other. And so we realized after a while, because we were trying so hard to get, you know, some constant relationship going between us, that that it won't work if we just don't ultimately find a film we can do together.
There was a profound energy, though, to the very first meeting, that first experience, that has always stayed with us. There was something we just like felt, the way the movie suggests that some people can come into your life and you know in the very moment that they're there that somehow they're affecting you and changing your life. And sometimes it's really like, you know, you fall in love and it's just like bang. But then there was, you know, we probably, if we hadn't have met him and started talking to him, we probably wouldn't have gone to Berlin for Vendetta. But because we were interested in having a relationship with him, and we had always had like sort of Xanadu relationship or Mecca relationship with Babelsberg, where you anyone who knows about cinema history knows it sort of is the origin point of the modern cinema studio world. Mm-hmm. You know, we were like, oh, it's still there, it's still standing. It's like we could go and actually shoot in the actual dust that is still there, that inhabited the dust that was Fritz Lang's motes in some of those incredible streaming beams of light that are in the art direction of that, or the cinematography of that Metropolis. And you know, because we wanted, you know, we went there to sort of hang out with him, and then we went. And he left the very day, you know, we landed on a plane, literally, this is literally the bad movie, right? Plane landing, plane taking off.
And he went off to see Perfume. Yeah.
And then we came back for Speed Racer, and we landed, and he took off to do the International.
Well, the sensibility makes sense. I mean, if you strip away the effects from your films, then Tom's sensibility really seems to be a good match.
Yeah,
we agree.
We felt the same. We felt very much, we look for similar things, even though we use different, you know, approaches here and there, but we have a very profound interest in similar, you know, both aesthetically, but also content-wise, you know, that, and it was just, you know, I think the way we found each other was also that in the same month, at least in America, The Matrix and Run, Lola, Run opened, which were both films that very strongly used structural devices and unusual forms of, you know, storytelling in order to get to express something in the most exciting and also entertaining mode that was ultimately at its core a philosophical examination of, you know, human struggle in any kind of, you know, in
David Mitchell ways. Has this funny way of describing it. He said both of us, Tom and us, he says that there are people who try to make highbrow movies and people who try to make lowbrow movies. It's like both of you try to make monobrow movies or one-brow movies.
One-brow
movies that like incorporate the best aspects of both.
Monobrows unite.
And then he sort of felt that's what we were trying to do with Cloud Atlas, which is what he tried to do with the novel.
So let's talk about religion for a second, because I mean, as I was watching Cloud Atlas, it
casual
really struck me.
Subject.
Huh?
Very casual subject.
Very casual light subject. But for me, that was particularly Matrix 2 and 3 and this film all seem to be connected in that way, and Heaven and other stuff that Tom has done, there definitely seems to be a very strong interest in making films about spirituality. There's all this other stuff going on that's visually powerful, but ultimately it always seems to come back to these issues of how people fit in their idea of spirituality and what is real and what is not.
Well, the question is rather whether we're not suggesting a strong direction there, in my opinion. We're really interested in the fact that there's, you know, which is more like a philosophical interest, actually, in the amount of unanswered questions, you know, and in the amount of things we struggle with understanding ourselves and the nature of life, once you put yourself in perspective to, you know, the concept of time. There's so many overwhelming concepts struggling with each other, and it's not that we don't tend towards some of them, but I think it's more that it's something we love as an exploration field for cinema in itself, that we don't feel that cinema should just be restricted to storytelling in a way that, you know, that connects characters in some dramatic situations, but that it should open your mind towards all, you know, all these other questions that lie around us. And it's not, I mean, particularly with Cloud Atlas, I'm always feeling, you know, even with myself, there were days where I was preferring, like, you know, to talk to an actor in a way that, you know, within your, let's say, genetic string that you're actually playing, rather than saying the soul that is connecting your characters, would probably be tempted to do this or that, and that there were different words and different description for the whole idea of eternal recurrence and of you know, what you might call reincarnation, which is a word that we're not afraid of. But at the same time, you know, if you really say it's a movie about reincarnation, we would feel like that's a limitation of perspective.
I agree. I mean, I think it does limit it, but I don't, because I think the thing that's fascinating endlessly is that there are all these pieces of it that keep showing up. In fact, I went back and watched Revolutions this afternoon, preparing for this, because
how was it?
It's still great, but it's, to me, I mean, the relationship people have with that picture, I think, speaks to their interest in the first movie and not to what your movie was actually saying. And when Neo is resurrected and he has a big cross come out of his chest, essentially in light, it's very powerful, but yet I don't feel like it's a Christian moment. I feel like it speaks to the idea of resurrection as something else.
Yeah, and transcendence of a material identity, that he is delimited in that moment, is more important to us than any kind of religious iconic things. But we're also trying to play with the meaning of the iconic symbols, because the third movie, like Cloud Atlas, asks you to participate in it. This is what we wanted to do with the trilogy, and it was the experiment from the beginning, was could you change the general way that audiences participate in a, let's say, an action movie, right? Mm-hmm. So you start off, and the first movie is the most typical movie, and we always said from the beginning, why don't people say what we thought immediately, which was movies are matrixes. Movies are things you go inside and they are immersive, and you are cocooned by them, and they tell you what to see, what to think, what to feel. And then we thought, well, that's for us problematic. We thought that what we were trying to achieve with the story overall was a shift, the same kind of shift that happens for Neo, that Neo goes from being in this sort of cocooned and programmed world to having to participate in the construction of meaning to his life. Mm-hmm. And we're like, well, can the audience go through the three movies and experience something similar to what the main character experiences? So the first movie is sort of classical in its approach, and the second movie is deconstructionist, and it assaults all of the things that you thought to be true in the first movie, and so people get very upset, and they're like, stop attacking me, in the same way that people get upset with deconstructionist philosophy. I mean, Derrida and Foucault, these people upset us. And then the third movie is the most ambiguous because it asks you to actually participate in the construction of meaning, which is what most religious, the essence, the elementary particle, mm-hmm. requires you to participate in the construction of meaning. And so Cloud Atlas was attractive to us because it did something similar. You read the book and there were connections that were only available if you lent yourself some, you know, if you brought your agency to the book. And in a way that, you know, David likes this concept of transmigration of souls, but really he's also interested in the secular exploration of consequence. And that was always, you know, in our conscious, we talked about it a lot, this Jose Saramago line that we reference, the nature of our immortal lives is in the consequence of our words and deeds that go on apportioning themselves throughout all time. This is a really beautiful secular way of expressing karma or reincarnation, mm-hmm. and that it's ambiguous, that it doesn't say your beliefs are false, or it doesn't say, you know, this atheist material thing is the only thing that exists. It has, like, when we wrote the Matrix trilogy, we had above our wall this amazing Schopenhauer quote that was the fundament upon all our, that all our knowledge and learning rests is the inexplicable. Mm-hmm. We're always interested, as storytellers, all three of us, in the nature of that inexplicability.
Well, I think it's in the film, I mean, I think part of what you come to Cloud Atlas with has to be not just the interest in all those elements, but also the openness to be willing to...
Do you want a cut for a tissue? Cut for a tissue.
So we read on God before you sneezed. Oh, yes, I think the thing about Cloud Atlas is that you not only have the journey that you guys have all created for us, but also the openness to be, the willingness to be open to it for the audience. I mean, I think the audience actually has to do some work because you haven't laid it out in a way that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, this story goes to this, to this, to this. Even in, forget about even the cutting, which is different, but just in terms of the storyline, following it is not a given. You know, what's happening for the character from one life to the next life is not necessarily a matching thing, and you don't make an effort to make it so.
But we feel that there is a way for the audience to enter the movie, and the reactions so far have been very, very... confirming, yes. That was the, so the reactions so far of people who've seen the movie have been very much confirming our hope that the way the movie works is quite a little bit similar to the novel itself, where you need a moment to organize yourself. What is this? Even though the structure is so different, but there's a sense of, a growing sense of trust into, you know, you're going to be guided, no? And there's even, Andy very often refers to these moments where even we speak to the audience through the actors. There's a very particular moment where once the field opens up to, like, intercutting between the sequences without any order anymore, but with an internal connectedness and the internal flow that seems to, that in our opinion even does make more sense than any other structure could have made for a movie, which is in the beginning of Reel 3, where Jim Sturgess as Chang meets Sonmi for the first time, and they have this moment, and he goes, well, you have a choice. You can stay here, or you can come with me. You know, mm-hmm. And this is the moment. You can stay with what you're used to, or you can go elsewhere and join us. And we felt like, okay, you've had 40 minutes to get prepared for it, and now you should take that choice. And then the movie takes off and goes, you know, suddenly goes back to, I mean, like in a very short period of time, it then goes through four different periods, intertwines them musically and by, you know, props being handed over into the next, you know, period, mm-hmm. or even by dissolves, where, you know, Frobisher crosses his own bed searching for this other half of a book, and you hear his voice over while he's talking to Sixsmith in his letter, and then suddenly you see Sixsmith 40 years later sitting on the same bed reading that letter that he wrote 40 years ago, and he's still in the image looking at his, the love of his past. And, you know, these kind of transitions which make it something, which suggest at least sometimes that you think, oh, you know, these kind of boundaries, you know, sometimes the movie could even, you know, periods could even maybe even take place in the same image. Well, they don't, you know, because it might be too confusing. But ultimately, from the sense that you get of it, that's what we're aiming for, because it is one tale with six stories.
You know, there's this trend in the industry where you're getting more movies where audiences, they go to the movies to turn off. We don't want to turn off when we go to the movies. We don't want a passive movie going experience. We want to be stimulated. We want to participate. And so
we want to go to dinner and have something to talk about.
I mean, you know, what is just like the Chris Farley character? Are you going to go to dinner and just say, "Oh, remember that one part?" So I don't know. It's us, you know, I don't know, trying to make a stand in terms of telling an adult epic film and something you've never seen before, like, you know, Tom Hanks cutting open Hugh Grant's throat.
Though it's funny because I think, like, Tom Hanks is not only shockingly good in this film, because you kind of forget sometimes that he's an actor. You know, he's been Tom Hanks for so long that you kind of expect Tom Hanks, and then you get a guy who's really a very skilled actor
Over and over again. Yeah. He is amazing as an actor. I have this new... He can do anything. He's like Michael Jordan. I mean, he would make things work that were dazzling to watch on the set, and we would give him crazy notes, and he would just go like, get this boyish glee to just act and to play, and we would say, well, you know, try Frank Gorshin, you know, Andy would yell out, "Frank Gorshin," and then he'd get this like brightness in his face and go, "Watch this," and then he'd like run out to the set and he'd do another take, and it was infectious. Everybody was inspired, and I mean, all of the actors came, and it was like, in the read-through, we started out, in the read-through, which is usually, can be, it's, we often have pretty good read-throughs, but this read-through was the greatest read. Plus, it was the music was playing at the same time. And all of the actors began playing, and they started, like, getting really into it. And then because they went a little further, Jim Broadbent would go, and then Hugh Grant would go farther, and then Tom Hanks wanted to up his performance. And soon we were hearing these variations and this life to the lines. And David Mitchell was actually sitting in the room. And he was listening to it, and it was over, and he looked at me, he's like, "I cannot believe this." And we're like, "What?" He's like, "I feel so inadequate as a writer. I heard Cavendish in my head when I wrote that line. I heard him say this in this one way, and then I just heard Jim Sturgis just riff on like four different versions of that line, and they were all better than the way I had it in my head." He had this new profound revelatory experience with what the art form of acting is, and watching a lot of these actors work on this film was a dream for us, because we love watching acting, we love playing with actors, working with actors, and they all, with such abandonment and courage and faith, they leapt into this movie.
Well, I mean, especially Tom. I mean, there was a part of me that, because he did so many things that you'd never seen him do before, there was a part of me that wanted to include, "And introducing Tom."
What is? It's like, it's, and he also, it's almost like, because he is Tom Hanks in a way, and you're with him as an audience, and you have so much connection to him, it makes the movie more accessible.
Yeah,
it gives it gives you the freedom to as an audience to go with the flow. Yeah. Of course, who the hell knew that Hugh Grant could do any of that? Yeah. I mean, he's
our
revelatory
casting agent, Laura Kennedy. She was like, "He's an amazing actor. He send him the script." And we thought, you know, they're so despicable. These characters are so despicable. Mm-hmm. He'll feel insulted. And she just urged us. She demanded we send him the script. And he sent the script. And we went into this meeting in London. And he was like, "You must really hate me. Or maybe you think I'm an interesting actor." And we were like, the latter.
Because he did. It's amazing. And Jim really almost has the hardest job, because he's a playing straight man through almost everything. And yet he brings a character to it that's really very compelling.
Jim Sturgis?
Yeah, Jim Sturgis is kind of like the... you know.
He had a really hard part. You don't understand casting it, again, because you're looking for this character who can play a hero, an action hero, and then he has to play this, like, very kind of kind, sweet victim.
Prey.
That Tom Hanks would see as a predator and just go, like, I can lunch on that guy.
That's a snack.
Yeah,
that's a morsel.
And it was not easy. When you started looking, you know, actors tend to be one or the other. They tend to be these sort of like, and you would like, you'd be like, why wouldn't that guy just break Tom Hanks in half? Or, you know, they tend to be so... you know, sort of sensitive that you can't imagine they would be this action hero. And Jim Sturgis did an extraordinary job making them both very believable.
So how hard was it, I know, how hard was it for you guys functionally to make it work? I mean, there's a lot going on. You're shooting two different movies. You're shooting six different movies, but you're shooting separately, and yet you're cutting it together, and then you're in the editing room. Figure out how to do all this before you started, or did it?
No, it was more organic. I mean, we're the type of filmmakers who go into the process with love in our heart, and we embrace the idea of film as a communal project. It's a social art form, and so if you have our two units separately and then combine them, because we're approaching filmmaking from a similar philosophy, everything was able to gel fairly easily. I mean, and it didn't seem like maybe that could be the case. You know, heads of department, from, you know, the DP to the production designer to the costume designer. I mean, they all sort of took their cue from us, and, you know, we had written the script together and started planning the pre-production together, and, you know, we got everybody in the room and say, okay, guys, play nice.
It was a really beautiful, because we were like, okay, we're getting married, we're going to be this threesome, and then we kind of had this big, giant group marriage where we had all of the department heads and said, okay, you guys are going to play together, and you guys are going to be together, and you're going to, and it was a testament to the wonderful people we work with that they leapt to it, and they, you know, the costume designers began immediately, like, oh, well, we can do this. I had this idea. How about this? The DPs, like, poured over books together, and I think the texture and the life of the film is related to how many amazing artists are working on it and participating in it.
Of course, they all come together for you all. I mean, that's a big part of it. You guys have managed over the last 15 years to make films that, on a scale and in an artistic demand level, that other people just haven't even tried.
Aww,
even some of the great
that's
people.
That's very sweet of you.
But no, true, don't.
We think so.
So are you all going to be less shy now? Is that the new?
No.
No? You're not going to come out and have a longer conversation?
It's an exception. I dragged them in here. I brought them with
maybe.
Me.
But, you know,
it's not that we, sometimes people, I'm afraid that people think that it was a judgment about the process or the people out there or the press, and it was never that. We just really love anonymity, and we're giving it up for a lot of reasons, some personal, you know, I have a responsibility, I feel, to a GLBT community, and my brother is very supportive, and he's been very supportive. So, and then this movie is special to us, and we love it so much, and we want people to see it, and we hope that it helps inspire other filmmakers to try to make really adult, large-scale cinema, because we want to go to those movies too. We want to see, you know, we don't want our the thing that we love about cinema to continue to contract and shrink, which is sort of where it's heading.
Well, also, it's, you know, I so many, who wants to talk endlessly about themselves?
Oh my God.
And who wants to, why do I have to, okay, I got to write the movie, I got to make the movie. Now I got to sit with you and explain it to you. I can't do some of the work.
But there's a romantic, you know, there's so much good stuff to talk about that it feels like that you have been part of a community that, and giving so much and so made so many people think about so many different things, and then not been there for the conversation. It's almost like Kubrick, who I love to death, is still my favorite guy of all time, but I wish I had had a chance to sit down with a guy and talk to him.
And here's one other thing about it. Because it's a communal art form, the people who are, I'm not solely responsible for what the movie is. It's like, the people who are making the movie are, you know, the costume, the actors, the costume designer, the production designer. They're all putting ideas into the film. So I can't totally, if I'm the one who's saying what the movie is and what it's about, it's limiting what the actual real definition is. And so I don't think that, you know, I mean, maybe it's an excuse, but...
So that statement is as important as any definition that you might give a movie.
Right.
You know, the unwillingness to give that definition. I mean, Haneke, talk to him about his movies, and you get nothing. I mean, he will not talk about the complexities. He actually talks more about it more because it's not as tricky, I guess, as some of the other work. But it's, you know, I completely respect filmmakers' reasons not to talk or to define their work for everybody. But at the same time, it's kind of like this well of movie love that you kind of want to dig into every once in a while.
Sure.
Yes. Well, you know, we get it. I mean, we're developing some relationships, and, you know, it's not like we're going to go off into Siberia again. But
yeah, it's maybe fair to both say.
We're going to go develop relationships fair. With other people.
It's fair to say that. That when we were young.
Are we leaving?
We are.
Okay. We were young, and we read Cahiers de Cinema. It was formation. So we understand the significance of engaging with the artists. And, you know, when I've read...
Are we going to this other
one? Yeah, I've read that. Yes. Roy Anderson has done. And that's been... I've loved it. Mm-hmm. Even though he doesn't do a lot. I love his little strange documentaries that he's done. Mm-hmm. And they've given me an access to his work that I didn't have before. But we do... Every artist hears somebody trying to say, this is the definition, mm-hmm. this is the relation of their work.